Lord of all creation, the water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle.
Thank you for watching Zohar House of Prayer's live broadcast. We stream live every Sunday morning and would like to invite you to come out and be in service with us. Sunday school starts at 10 a.m. and morning worship begins at 11 a.m. We are located 3.5 miles past the Morgantown Mall on 19 South. Take a right onto Sugar Grove Road for a mile and the church sits on the right with a sign at the foot of the hill. Thank you and God bless.
What the Bible said, no man can call Jesus Lord but by the Holy Ghost, unless the Spirit of God sets us free and shows us, amen, that this is not the image of who I am. God made me for more than this. And say, Jesus, I'm coming out of this. This is not for me. The devil has lied to me, and I'm not living under that lie anymore. I am a new creature through Jesus Christ. Wash me in your blood. Come into my life. And Jesus, right now, I receive you as my Savior and Lord.
Holy, precious Lord, reveal your heart to me. Father,
See, that's one way to get the service started. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. All right, I know we've done this song Sunday morning, but I just feel led to do it again. We're going to do 117 in the Praise and Worship book tonight. And I know everybody knows the song, but we're going to sing it.
What's the name?
Our God is Greater. 117. And our God is greatly to be praised tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I was running a little bit late tonight. I got a truck got in front of me from Lowe's, and I couldn't get here. And he was just so slow, and I didn't think I was ever going to get here. But I made it, praise the Lord. And that's all that matters. I'm here. And Jesus is in the house. He's here. That's all that matters. All right, here we go.
Awesome in power, our God.
sing, our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Somebody, who are we going to trust?
Jesus.
Are we going to trust in man?
No.
Who are we going to trust in?
Jesus.
The Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That's who we're going to put our trust in. Hallelujah. He is the author. He is the finisher of our faith. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
130.
Letting go of every single dream, I laid each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering, never changing what
I will trust in you.
Said, Alan, just wait till tomorrow night when I'm here. So we'll do Jesus Messiah tomorrow night because she loves that song. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Let's get ready to thrive, church. And when you sing it like you mean it. Like you're going to thrive. I mean, you're going to just get up and run out of this place. But don't do that till after the word. All right, here we go.
Here we go.
warm and free land of any dreams that die. Like a tree planted by the water, it never will run dry. So
do you believe it tonight, church?
Yeah.
to thrive, church. We were made in the likeness of Him. Hallelujah. We were made in the likeness of the Lord. Because He wants us to thrive. He wants us to tell others that He's coming back again. Hallelujah. That He sits at the right hand of His Father, making intercession for us, church. And anytime we want to call on that name, we have that right. Hallelujah. Because we have accepted Jesus into our lives. Hallelujah. Praise God. Is there anyone tonight that would like to testify? Praise God. I don't want anybody to leave without testifying, saying you had the opportunity. I want to give it to you right now. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
God is good.
All the time He's good.
I have.
Thank you, Lord.
A couple of Sundays ago, I went up to the altar to pray for my dad.
Praise Jesus.
Had an alcohol problem for a while now. Mm-hmm. And I get a call 2 days ago to say that my dad has been sober for almost 2 weeks now.
Praise the Lord. That's wonderful. That's wonderful.
I've been praying so much.
Hallelujah.
I've been trying to get my dad saved. I've been trying to get my grandfather saved. Mm-hmm. And just to hear that he has been sober for 2 weeks now is just, God is amazing.
Yes,
and
He is.
I want to thank Him for doing everything that He does for me and doing it for my family.
Jesus.
And my pap will be coming to revival either tomorrow night or Saturday night.
All right. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
He's been telling me he wants to go to the altar himself and put cigarettes down because he has an aneurysm by his heart and he has to quit smoking completely. And the words I told him was they need to go to the altar and need to put them down.
Yes.
And the fact that I have been praying for him to come and give his heart to the Lord, and the fact that he's wanting to do that, it's just amazing in my eyes. So I just want to
praise
thank God
that's
for
wonderful.
Saving my dad from alcohol and bringing my path to the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Let's keep praying for her dad. You know, that he can continue to where he don't have that desire to want to drink. You know, let's just pray for him. And I've got a testimony. The last time we was in revival, I came up and I asked Brother Frank. I wanted him to pray that God would help us to get a home. And he made the way. Let me tell you, we have a brand new single wife. And I know it was God. He was the one that did it. It wasn't man. He told me it was him, and he always makes the way. And I give God praise for it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Anyone else tonight? Okay, speak up, honey.
Okay. You guys probably don't know, but I had a panic attack out in the car.
Oh, my. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I know what it is.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So it didn't have anything to do with Justin? Oh, Lord. I thought maybe he had something to do with you. All right. Go ahead, Brother Ron.
I just want to praise and thank God. How many of God is good?
All the time. Yes, He is.
Well, I want to thank Him because, you know, He's good beyond what we ask.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I prayed last for a miracle, and in June, I needed $2,500. The Lord, within 10 days, gave me a check of $10,000.
Ooh,
God is awesome.
Yes, He sure is.
I told God, why are you doing it? He said, so you can share it with my people because I am able to perform anything
yes,
you ask.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I was just approached that this month by $9,000
car
loan. Wait,
that. Hallelujah.
And I thanked him because I said, God, why are you doing that? He said, because I want faith in my house that they can move mountains. Because what I said, they could move a mountain. I meant they could move a mountain.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
I thank God for your houses to be paid off. I thank God for your cars to be paid off. I thank God for every step in this house.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
But he is able to do it.
Yes, he
Hallelujah.
Is. Yes, he is.
Your houses are paid in Jesus' name. Who's that?
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Before they even get to the preach.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He is a good God.
Yes, he is. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anyone else tonight? Praise God. I don't want to turn anybody away. Give everyone an opportunity.
I'm gonna follow that.
All right.
Wow.
Thank you,
Jesus. My grandson, 11 years old, and he went to school today, and he had had two teeth removed, but my daughter sent him to school anyways. And I said, are you crazy?
Mm-hmm.
I said, so we went to the university, and they said, bring him in. We went to school and got him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, instead of having two teeth removed, he had had three done.
Oh, my.
When he got out, he said he had no pain.
Praise
no
the
pain.
Lord.
No pain.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Sister Connie, do you have a word for the Lord or a song or anything?
Well, I always have a song in my head.
All right. That's all right. Come on up and sing. We'll let you sing.
The red one. Red or blue?
So now that I'm up here, I have a testimony as well. My precious pastor, my aunt, my best friend, and a lot of times my mom, growing up, I was going through a situation with my son, Michael. You have a son, Michael. It was difficult because he was kind of fading into some depression, and it was very difficult to see that and hear that. And so I've been praying for him, and God led on my heart to put like scripture, you know, I need to do scriptures. I was sending, would text him scriptures on his phone a lot, and just really be praying about something to touch him. And Barbara said, well, because I had given him, gave him a birthday card with scriptures in it, Jeremiah 29:11, and some other scriptures, what God began, that good work that God began, and he will see it through. And so Barbara said, well, it sounds to me like you have your answer, you know, put those scriptures up on the wall. So I put a scripture in the bathroom where he would see it. It's still up there because he says he wants to be reminded of that every day, but it's Psalms 18. If you ever get a chance to read it, read 1 and 2, chapter 1, or chapter 18, first and second verse, because God is everything that we ever need, just as Alan was saying. He's everything we will ever need in any situation that comes our way. He's already made a way out. He's already made a way out. Thank you, Jesus. I love this song, so listen to the words. This is the air I breathe. You are the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me.
What the name of the song is, and
The blood is still there. I'm so glad tonight to know that his blood is still there, that no matter what we go through, you know, he paid that price for you and I. Thank you.
Gives us this lifetime. Those that are watching by internet, I just feel compelled to say it. God gives us this lifetime to make a decision for Jesus Christ. The Bible says, as a tree falls, so shall it lie. And however you go out of this world, that's the way you're pointed to for eternity. Come on, amen. I've got news for you. Ain't nobody going to pray you out, pray you back. Come on, amen. It's heaven or hell. There's one or the other. And it's not God's will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So before the opponents of the Lord get upset and rise up and say, why would God send anybody to hell? He didn't send anybody to hell. You make a decision. People make a decision. Come on, amen. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I'm so glad, amen, whosoever will can come and drink of that living water. The blood, amen, that gives me strength will never lose its power. Amen. Well, it's wonderful to have my beautiful wife with me. I was, I'm just so excited that she was able to come along and be with us tonight. And I have nothing but praise and honor and glory to the Lord for how good he's been to us and our family. Since we've been together last time, I picked up a son-in-law and a daughter-in-law. So we got two more children in our family. And Michael Motorcycle got married 2 weeks ago this Saturday. And he and Allie are just, I'll tell you what, it just makes me laugh every time I see them. I'm so excited for them, and their heart is for ministry, to serve the Lord, and I thank God for that. So somebody said, well, that makes you and Ruthie empty nesters. Uh-oh. I don't think so. Not when you have 7 grandkids and number 8's on the way. So anyway, amen. We're just excited about what the Lord is doing in our lives. And glad to be with you. And Sister Barbara, thank you for inviting us to come back again. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to invite you to turn to 1 Chronicles. That's where I want to go tonight. 1 Chronicles chapter 13. And then if you keep your finger there, you want to turn back to 2 Samuel chapter 6. 1 Chronicles in the Old Testament chapter 13, 2 Samuel chapter 6. Samuel comes a little bit before Chronicles. Amen. Did we put the verses up on the screen? I forgot. Or no, Brother Mike. Okay, I couldn't remember. That's fine. No, that's fine. That's fine. I just didn't know if we did that or not. I couldn't remember. Praise be the name of the Lord. Let's just pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you for the word of God. I thank you that God, our God, reigns. And Lord, tonight the heavens are your throne and the earth is your footstool. And Lord, there are many that say there is no God. But Lord, it doesn't matter what they say. That's not going to make you disappear. It's not going to make you less of who you are. Lord, if we deny you, you cannot deny yourself because you're faithful. And I thank you tonight, hallelujah, that you are God and beside you there is none other. And I ask tonight, Lord, as we proclaim the word of God, you said through the foolishness of preaching that that's what you've chosen to bring men to the knowledge of Almighty God and that they have a need for Christ. And I pray tonight that you would open up hearts and lives. Lord, there's a cry that's coming out of my heart tonight. And I pray a cry that's coming from your people. And I pray this evening as we minister the word that you will give us ears to hear what the Holy Ghost will say. God, that we will hear what the Spirit is saying to the church right now. And Lord, I just cry out with Moses and those of old who have all cried throughout the centuries, Lord, show us your glory. Let your manifested presence show up in this place tonight, and may we see and know that our God is God, that he is a living God. And I pray tonight, all those who will call on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. Lord, let the sick be healed, the empty filled. Let, Lord God, those that, Lord, are depressed be revived and bring back to life those, Lord God, that may be backslid. And Lord, the sinner, Lord God, that they will call on the name of Jesus tonight and be cleansed and be a new creature in Christ. Have your way tonight and the rest of this meeting. In Jesus' name, praise God. Appreciate all the testimonies that were given. 1 Chronicles chapter 13, look at verse 13 and 14 if you will. 1 Chronicles 13, verse 13 and 14. I just want to read this verse. So David brought not the ark home to himself. The ark there is the Ark of the Covenant. It's not Noah's ark, okay? It's the Ark of the Covenant. David brought not the ark home to himself to the city of David, which is Jerusalem, but carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. And as a result of the ark being in Obed-Edom's house, look what it says, and the ark of God remained with the family of Obed-Edom in his house 3 months, and as a result, and the Lord blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that he had. Now let's go back to 2 Samuel chapter 6, and we're reading the same passage of Scripture because this event is recorded in 2 Samuel 6 and also 1 Chronicles 13. And I just want to read it as it is recorded in 2 Samuel 6, verse 11. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. Bless everything that he had, it said in Chronicles, and all of his household in 2 Samuel. How many understand that from the beginning of time, God's entire plan was that he might walk with, talk with, and fellowship with mankind? We were created in the image and likeness. From the beginning of time, we see that it was God's plan to allow the glory and his presence to accompany man, to walk. God came in the cool of the day, and the Bible said every day he walked with his creation in that garden. He talked. He revealed himself, amen, to his creation. Can I tell you it's nonetheless today? I think it amazing whenever I look back and after the garden experience, we have Abraham. And how many remember in Genesis, I believe it's recorded in chapter 15, where God comes by with the two angels that are on their way to Sodom and Gomorrah, and he stops by the tent of Abraham. Anybody remember that? The Bible says that Abraham recognizes him and says, Lord, will you come in for a meal? Amen. And God says, yes, I'm going to come to your house for a meal. Can I tell you, that's the intent of God. Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and I will sup. Come on, amen. I'm going to have a meal with you. It's nonetheless today, hallelujah, that God desires eternal fellowship, amen, with his creation. Can you imagine eating and making a supper for God? Hey, ladies, can you imagine how Miss Sarah felt when Abraham said, hey, honey, we got some visitors tonight. And Sarah says, who? And he says, God. God came by. Hallelujah. And you're going to make a meal for God. Huh? Come on. Hey, I imagine that put the pressure on. Huh? I've been to people's houses and they say stuff like this. Oh, I didn't make this right. It doesn't taste right, Pastor. I got a little bit darker than what. Oh, come on. Amen. Can you imagine how Sarah felt, ladies? She's making a meal for God. Amen. And Abraham fellowshiped with the Lord. And the Lord revealed his plan to Abraham and said, shall I hide anything from him, seeing that he will command his children in the next generation? I don't know about you, but I want to be a friend of God. Amen. I like that song. I am a friend of God. Hallelujah. I am God's friend. God reveals the plans about Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's another message at another time. But the thought was that God wants to have fellowship with us. How about Jacob, Abraham's grandson? Two generations later, the Bible said that Jacob is running from the wrath of his twin brother Esau. And he's made him so mad that Esau wants to kill him. And Jacob's wandering. Come on, he's wandering away from home. And the Bible says he comes to a certain place. He had traveled all day and he got tired. And he grabs a rock and he pulls the rock up. And he makes the rock his pillow. And the Bible said he lays down to sleep. And no sooner than he gets asleep, amen, he has a dream. And the Bible says, Connie, that he sees a ladder that extends from heaven to earth. Can I tell you, there's still a ladder? Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. And angels were ascending and descending. And at the top of the ladder, amen, was Almighty God. And God revealed himself to Jacob. And God, amen, spoke to him the covenant promise. I'm glad that our God is a God of promise. I'm glad that he's a God of covenant. And he signed, sealed, and delivered it in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Oh my, he makes his promises good. He is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. If he said it, he'll do it. Come on, amen. If he proclaimed it, he'll make it good. If you got a word from God tonight, hold on to it. Hallelujah. Because the promises of God are sure and faithful. Amen. Your Bible says, Jacob wakes up the next morning and he was all worried. And he woke up and he said, my goodness, he said, God was here and I didn't even recognize him. Come on. I'm glad I recognize him tonight. I'm glad I know him tonight. I'm glad, hallelujah, amen, that he lives and he flows in me. Praise be the name of the Lord. Jacob takes the pillow that he used, that rock. And the Bible said that he pours oil upon it. That's a message in itself. We don't have time to go there. But he anoints that place. And he names the place where he laid. Your Bible says it was formerly known as Luz. L-U-Z. You know what Luz means? It means almond tree. It was a place where an almond tree grew. It was a place of little or no significance. But when Jacob woke up, he said, I'm renaming this place. Something special happened to me tonight, and I don't want to forget about it. Hallelujah. I'm going to put a rock, and there's an anointing here, and God's in this place. And he said, I call this place Bethel, which means the house of God. And I don't know about you, but I want to have a relationship. I want to have an encounter with Almighty God, that when I leave this place, I'll leave different, and I'll be able to say, this is a place of significance. Amen. Because God met me here. Amen. Huh? He had a few encounters there. He renamed it again, El Bethel. It just wasn't the house of God. It was about the God of the house of God. Come on, amen. And that's what it's about. It's not about Zor. It's about God. Hallelujah. It's about the Lord's presence. It's about people finding God in this place. Can somebody say with me, Lord, show us your glory.
Show us your glory.
Manifest your presence to me. Come on, amen. I want to know you in ways that I've yet to experience you. I want to taste and see your goodness. I want you to reveal yourself to me. Lord, show us your glory. If we say that this is a house of God, how many knows? When sinners come in, they ought to be able to find God here. I remember a story, a little comical, but I heard it several years ago, that there was a preacher looking for the church of God, and he drove into this little community, and he couldn't find it. There was a little boy riding his bike, and he pulled over and wound down the window, and he said, "Son, can you help me?" He said, "I'm a little bit lost. I'm looking for the church of God in this town." And the little boy, he started thinking. He said, "Well, over there's the Methodist church, and down that way's the Baptist church, and over there's the Presbyterian church." And he said, "Let's see, Lutheran church is over there." He said, "Mister, now that I think about it, I don't think God has a church in this town." Come on, Church of God. Zor House of Prayer, amen. How many knows if we announce we're in revival, we need to have the power of God here in His presence. He's in this house tonight. Come on. Somebody's been praying. Somebody's been fasting. Somebody's been seeking God. And we can say like these of old, "Lord, show us your glory." I believe I'm in a Pentecostal church tonight. And I believe Pentecostals need true Pentecost one more time. I believe we need the Spirit without measure. I believe we need, come on, a sound from heaven. I believe, oh, hallelujah. When Pentecost came, it was evident that the Holy Spirit was in the house. I want some evidence of His presence. Is this all right?
Yes.
Bible tells us that in the time of the law, the days of the law, the days of Moses, that God told Moses to build this Ark of the Covenant that we read about in our scripture. This was a wooden box that was overlaid with pure gold. A wooden box overlaid with pure gold. It was made of wood overlaid with gold. Somebody said, "What does that represent, preacher?" Well, I'm glad you asked me tonight. It represents both the deity and the humanity of Jesus Christ. It represents that He is the Son of Man, but He is also the Son of God. Come on, amen. He is God in the flesh. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh, John 1:14, and dwelt among us that we might behold His glory. Come on, amen. The glory of the Father, full of grace and truth. He was not just come from God. He was not just about God. But how many knows Jesus was and is God? He is not the older brother of Lucifer. Come on, as some teach. He is not the good brother and Lucifer the bad brother. Come on, amen. Your Bible said all things were created for Him and by Him and through Him and to Him. And without Him is nothing made. Amen, that was made. Listen, He made all power and principality. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. He's not equal with the devil. Amen. He created every being that is made. Come on. He is higher and more powerful. Satan wanted that name of God, but the Bible said that Jesus got it because God has given Him a name that's above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. Everybody that's watching tonight, amen, one day you're going to bow and confess and admit that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen.
Inside of this box, Moses was told by God to put something, a representation of glory, and a representation of God's presence here on this earth. Number one was the Word of God. Amen. Come on. Amen. The Ten Commandments were placed in there, God's Word. How many knows that represents the Word of God? The Word of God has to be the center of who we are. Amen. We cannot just know about it. We just can't quote it. We just can't memorize it. Come on, amen. We got to live it. We got to do it. Jesus said, whoever is a hearer and a hearer only is a foolish individual, building your life on the sand. And when the storm comes, your life is going to collapse. And great will be the fall of it. But he that hears and does my word is like a wise man who built a house upon the rock. And when the enemy tested it, how many knows the house stood? Because it was founded on the word of Almighty God. Jesus said heaven and earth will pass away, but his word will never pass away. Second thing inside that box was Aaron's rod that budded. That speaks of the life of God. It was nothing, Pastor, but a dead stick. That's all it was. It was a broken off branch, a dead stick. But when it was laid in before God, when it was laid in the presence of Almighty God, Aaron's rod budded. Come on, Aaron's rod came to life. Oh, hallelujah. I'm going to tell you, that's our life. It's the presence of Jesus. And I'm glad he lives in me. I just don't feel him in this house. I feel him when I leave this house because he's with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said in John 15:16, he said, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you that you should bring forth life. Amen. How many knows that that life is in the Son, Jesus Christ? He said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you'll ask whatever you will and it shall be done unto you. But apart from me, you are nothing. You're a dead, withered branch, only good for kindling wood. Come on, amen. But engrafted in him, hallelujah, you have the life of God inside of you. No life whatsoever apart from Christ. Third thing that was in that Ark of the Covenant. How many still with me tonight? Third thing that was in that box was a pot of manna, which represents God's daily provision that was only in his presence. Can you imagine? The Bible says God led them for 40 years through that wilderness. Should only taken them a few days, but because of their unbelief, God shut the door to the promised land, and that entire generation that was 20 years and upward died. Except for two men, Joshua and Caleb, because they had another spirit. They believed God, the Bible said. Amen. I don't know if that's because that's in my pocket. Could that be, brother? Do I need to just put it on my belt? That'd be better? Okay. But the Bible tells us, amen, that entire generation died 20 years and upward. God led them. God directed them every step of the way. And how many knows his glory was manifest for those 40 years? They saw their invisible God, which is a spirit, Jesus said in John chapter 4, verse 24 through 26. But they saw God, a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. Amen. How many knows that cloud by day gave them shade from the heat of the desert? How many knows that the fire by night gave them warmth, come on, and a nightlight, amen, in the coolness of the desert and the darkness of the desert? God became everything they needed. He became rock, come on, that came out of a standing, or water that came out of a rock, out of standing flint, but he also became bread. And when they said, we're hungry, God opened up heaven, come on, amen, and sent down angels, food, angels, bread, and covered the ground, and 6 days a week, amen, the manna covered the ground, and they were instructed to collect enough just for your family, your household. Don't get any extra. How many knows they disobeyed? They disbelieved God. They said, well, we better get while the getting's good. We don't know when there'll be more. God said you'll be more tomorrow. Amen. But they didn't believe God. And they gathered it up, and the Bible said it bred worms and it stunk. Come on, amen. And it spoiled. Amen. Huh? He said, you take every for every day that you need. How many knows that's the Lord's prayer? Give us this day our daily bread. Can we trust him on a daily basis? Can we trust him if it looks like the economy's gone down? Can we trust him if they say you're going to lose your job? Can we trust him if they say, come on, amen, you might not have income next week? Come on, can we trust him if they say one day we're going to do away with Social Security? Can we trust him? We can shout while it's good. Come on, somebody. Come on. On the sixth day, you'll gather enough for 2 days. And on that sixth day, you're not going to gather on the Sabbath. You're not going to go out there and look for food. You're going to eat what you got the day before, and I'll keep it on that day and that day only. And God did that for the next 40 years. Huh? And that pot of manna reminded them that I am your Jehovah Jireh. I'm the God that sees your need and meets your need. Oh, come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Oh, my. How many knows that was only in his presence? Moses would hear from God, have a trumpet blown, and that trumpet would tell them, pack up. God said, we're moving. Come on, amen. The cloud would stop. The fire would stop. Amen. But when God was going to move, how many knows they had to pack up and move with God? How many knows today we have to follow the Holy Ghost? Come on. Amen. We have to follow him wherever he leads. If we want provision, if we want the word, if we want life, how many knows we got the life is in the spirit? Come on, somebody. We got to follow God. We got to be spirit-led and spirit-filled. Huh? People don't want that, and then they wonder why they're doing without. How many knows it's only in the presence of God? Yes. Am I preaching it right, Pastor?
Yes.
Go back in the Old Testament, the trumpet blows, and everybody starts packing up, and some old saint says, I ain't gone nowhere. I'm tired, you know. Maybe some woman tells her man, I want a little bit of security. I like it here. It's cool here in the day. It's warm at night. We got a lot of light. We got bread. I'm just staying here. How many understand that? And everybody in Israel packs up, and that family, you know, he tries to tell his wife, but his wife said, I'm staying here. I talked to the hand. I'm not listening. Huh? And so they go before Moses and say, Brother Pastor Moses, I'm sorry, but my wife likes it here. I can't change her mind. We're going to stay here. And he says, you better come on. You better come on with the family of God. We're following God. No, we're just going to stay here. How many knows they weren't gone 10 minutes? And the heat's gone up. Come on, amen. The cloud's gone. Come on, amen. And they stick it out through the blistering heat. And that night they're frigid cold and it's dark. And there's no man on the ground. And finally, amen, they repent and say, Dear God, we miss God. Hallelujah. We need to catch up with the children. Huh? Come on, amen. There was provision in his presence. Then Moses was told to make a crown or a lid for the box. Anybody remember that? That crown on top of it were two angels of pure gold with wings touching, looking down upon what that lid was called the mercy seat. And it was there once a year that the high priest alone took the blood of a lamb, spotless, and sprinkled the blood on the mercy seat and the altar. Come on, amen, come on. And God would look down, and on that mercy seat, that blood would cover his people, that entire nation, for a year's period of time. But there had to be continual sacrifices until one day Jesus came, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And he has entered in once into that holy place. Come on, amen. To the real Ark of the Covenant. Right into the throne room of God. And hallelujah, his blood now speaks for us. God said, over top of that mercy seat, I'll meet you. Over top of that mercy seat, when I come down to talk with you, I will meet you there. And how many knows that glory cloud came down, and when all Israel saw the cloud over the tabernacle, over that Ark of the Covenant, they knew God was there. Amen. That's when Moses would go in, and God would speak and reveal himself to him. Come on, amen. That Ark of the Covenant. How many knows that Ark of the Covenant became a spoil of war? Come on, is somebody with me tonight? How many knows that Ark of the Covenant that became a prize or a spoil of war, wanting to be captured by the enemies? It represented the presence of God on earth among his people. And how many knows in 1 Samuel chapter 5, the Philistines did just that. They captured the Ark of the Covenant. Anybody remembering this?
Yeah.
I don't know how far we'll get tonight. It really don't matter. I just feel the Holy Ghost tonight.
Amen.
I'm just painting a picture for you tonight. Come on, amen. I love the Word of God. Bible says that Israel went out against the Philistines. The Philistines, the enemy, rose up, and Israel went out to fight. And the Bible said that they lost that day. And the people were all sitting around licking their wounds and wondering, how in the world could we have lost? And somebody says, oh my goodness, we forgot. Huh? I mean, there's the commercial. I could have had a V8. Amen. We forgot. We don't have the box. Every time we have the box, we won the battle. And this time we forgot to bring the box. And they speak to two backslidden preachers. Come on. Let's paint the picture how it was. Two preachers who had a title of pastor, but how many knows they had no character to be the pastor? Can I tell you, if you ever want a visible manifestation and experience the glory of God, you're going to have to get holy. Amen. And the only way to be holy is be you holy, for I am holy. And that's to come, confess your sin, repent of it, and let the blood cleanse you and stay under the blood covenant. Come on. Amen. Two backslidden preachers said, we need to go get the box. We need the ark. We forgot the ark. And they began to handle the things of God lightly. Can I tell you, we need to get back in the church where we know how to handle holy things. People nowadays, they want to be filled with the Spirit and lay hands and prophesy and speak in tongues and do miracles and everything else, but they don't want to live right. See, the amens went down a little bit. That's okay. That's okay. God's speaking to us tonight. Search your soul tonight. Let this message search. Are you really hungry for a manifestation of His presence? Do you really want to know God? Do you really want to go after God? Do you really want to be genuine? Then you got to deal with sin. You got to deal with sin in your life. You have to deal with it at the foot of the cross. Everybody watching me, this is a message for everybody, in building and out of the building. I don't care what country you're listening from. Last time I was here, we had calls from Indonesia and England and Europe. And I don't care where you're watching from tonight. Amen. It's the same. God said, be ye holy, for I am holy. And I have no holiness. I have no righteousness in myself. My righteousness is the blood. My holiness is the Lord. So Hophni and Phinehas, read it for yourself, 1 Samuel 5. Make sure I'm preaching it right to you. Old Hophni and Phinehas, they go get the box. And they come out with the box, and Israel shout, when they saw the ark, when they saw the box, oh, my brother Alan, they shouted so much, was great was their shout, that it echoed into the enemy's camp. And Justin, the Bible said that the Philistines, the enemies, when they heard the shout of Israel and so much joy, they thought, oh no, Jehovah God's entered into their presence now. We're dead men now. Come on. We had a chance against them, but we don't have a chance against God. You want to live victorious over Satan and all those demonic spirits? Come on, get connected with God. Let God fight your battles. Let God be for you. Because if God be for us, who can be against us? Ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost. I feel it in this place. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Have your way. But they encouraged themselves. And they said, all right, men, don't give up. Come on, pull up your bootstraps. We're going to go and be valiant and be courageous. And how many knows, even though they had the box, the God of the box stayed back at Shiloh. God didn't go with them. See, people are wearing crosses. Come on, amen. People are wearing WWJDs and bumper stickers, honk if you love Jesus, and wearing Christian t-shirts. How many knows you can wear all of the paraphernalia and not have God anywhere in the midst of your heart? You can carry Bibles. You can call yourself Christian. You can come to church. You can sing the songs. You can play the game and still not have Jesus Christ in your heart and in your life. God knows those that are His. Let everyone that names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Live a holy life. Your Bible says that at the end of the day, they had the box, but they didn't have God. And at the end of the day, Israel was smitten. and they suffered a great defeat. Now here is Eli, he's the high priest, and he's sitting on the wall, amen, back at Shiloh, and he's eagerly waiting for a report, and as he looks out, Pastor Barb, he sees somebody running, and it's a messenger. And somebody comes running up to him, and I mean they're out of breath. And they said, oh, high priest, we got, and he says, how goes the battle? He said, that's what I came to tell you. And Eli's waiting, and he hears the news, and here's how it goes in this order. Israel has suffered defeat. Oh, how many knows that? That hit the old man. He was an old prophet. He was an old priest, old high priest. It hit Eli and said, there are thousands dead laying on the battlefield. Oh, no. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but both of your sons died in the battle. Hophni and Phinehas are dead. Oh, no. That was enough to kill a man. But that wasn't the clincher. The word that got his attention and caused his death was, and high priest, the Ark of the Covenant has been captured and stolen. And the Bible said that man fell off backward, and because he was a heavy man like Brother Menhart, come on, amen, he broke his neck when he hit the ground and he died. Now somebody had to take that news to his daughter-in-law who was pregnant with one of those son's children. And they come to her tent and they sit down and they say, sister, we don't know how to break it to you, but I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but Israel was defeated today and thousands are dead. Oh no. Your brother-in-law died. What? Oh no. Your husband is dead. He'll never see your unborn child. Oh no. Your father-in-law just died. And with all of that, how many knows that'd be enough to crush somebody? Got to have three family funerals. Come on, amen. Your husband, your brother-in-law, and your father-in-law, bury them all in one day. But that wasn't the clincher that got her. And once they gave the last report, and the Ark of the Covenant has been captured, the Bible says that she went into premature labor. She wasn't ready to give birth yet. She went into premature labor, and the Bible said, listen to this, that in the birthing of that child, she would die in childbirth. Can I say something? That when the ark was stolen, there was a lot of death left among the people. Are you catching it? You got it, Sister Barb. You're going to help me preach it. There's a lot of places that call themselves God and the house of God, and they have Bibles. How many knows? But it's filled with death. And the presence of God can't be felt. And the presence of God isn't welcome. And the presence of God is misunderstood. And the presence of God is not there. My question is, how bad does it have to get before we hunger for the presence of God? How much death and destruction has to come to a place until we realize, dear God, amen, we have forsaken you. We've lost something. With her dying breath, she prematurely brings into this world a son. And the handmaid who is aiding in bringing that child in the world takes that little baby, can't you picture it, wraps it up in a blanket, and just to give her a word of hope, says, look, it's a man child. This little boy will carry on the family name and the lineage of your father-in-law, your husband, and your brother-in-law. But instead of joy, Brother Mike, the Bible says with her dying breath, she points at that little child, and she says, your name, little man, is Ichabod. Anybody know what that means? The glory of the Lord has departed. There's no glory. There's nothing to be excited about. There's nothing to be joyful about. Would to God, as Joel prophesied, that the priest would weep between the porch and the altar and cry out for the presence and the glory and the Spirit of God. Come on, amen. There is no joy today. Your name is, oh, what a name, what a name. Every time that he was called, amen, that name would be a representation of the glory and the power and the presence of God departing. Do you know that in the literal Hebrew, it actually translates this way? Where is the glory? Nobody in the churches today are asking where the glory is. We're continuing to do things. Some places are twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Come on, amen. Have no life, no spirit, no power, and yet we're still coming and going and doing the same rigmarole. Come on, amen. And going through the same routine, void of the person and the power of Almighty God.
Amen.
Where's the glory? Where's the glory in our individual lives? No glory in our own lives. Where's the glory in our homes as godly homes? No glory in our homes. Where's the glory in our corporate meetings? Amen. When the church comes in. And nobody's asking, where is the glory? Your Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 2 that when the Israel forsook the Lord, they committed two evils against God. Listen to what God says. Number one, you've forsaken me. You've left me, amen, the fountain of living water. I'm the giver of life. I'm the fountain of water. And you have forsaken me. But number two, he said, not only have you forsaken me, but now you have attempted to dig out for yourself cisterns, broken cisterns that can't hold water. You don't want the life-giving flow. You want something that'll contain, that'll get you by for a while. But he said, that isn't working either, because the cisterns you're trying to build are broken and you have no water and you're empty. And when are you going to come back to me, God? That's what he said. Jeremiah said, how long is there going to have to be famine in the land? How long are the people going to have to cry before they cry out for the living God? Elijah, when he comes to the scene, says the same thing on Mount Carmel. If the Lord be God, serve him. If Baal be God, serve him. Why are you halting between two opinions? We can't stay here. We can't continue. Come on, without his presence. Is this making anybody hungry for God tonight? If I can whet your appetite tonight to go after God and realize I've lost something, but listen, it can be regained. Hallelujah. Then I believe the Lord will use me tonight. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost this evening. I pray this is ministering to your heart. Spirit of God, please speak through me tonight. Please, Lord, I'm hungry. God, we're hungry. We're hungry. My. Your Bible says that the Philistines in 1 Samuel chapter 6, we'll move from the 5th chapter where it was captured, where all the death and the bad news came to Israel, where they recognized, my goodness, we are nothing without God. See, that's where America has to come back to. We have to realize we have to return to God. We have to realize that the Bible meant what it said and said what it meant when God said the nation that forsakes the Lord will be turned into hell. We have to realize that the chaos that's going on. Oh, I'm preaching this to some Americans tonight. The chaos that's going on is our country. It isn't a Democrat thing or Republican thing or a liberal thing. What it is, amen, it's a lack of God thing. We need God back. Amen in America. Come on, somebody give God praise. Somebody tell him, God, we need you back. God, forgive us. And Lord, restore your glory. Let us be, oh Lord, lift America. Hallelujah. I'm out of the pit tonight. Lift us up, oh God. Lift us up, oh God. Oh, we're hungry, God. We're thirsty, God. We need you, God. We need you, God. You can be seated just for a few more moments. I don't see how I'll get through the rest of this tonight, but that's all right. God wants me to do it tomorrow. I'll do it. If not, I'll do something else. But this needs to be heard. Come on, it needs to be proclaimed. We got to get hungry and we got to get thirsty for God. I can't do this without God. We can't have church without God. People are trying to do things with gimmicks. Come on, amen. They're trying to do things in flesh. And if it starts with flesh, it'll have to continue with flesh. But we're called to the things of the Spirit.
Amen.
Mm. I really believe nobody wants to pay the price to do it God's way. didn't hear one amen on that, but that's okay. I saw two head shakes, and that was really, really quiet. Thank you, buddy. The Philistines take that Ark of the Covenant, and they take it back to their city, and they put it in the temple of their god, Dagon. Dagon. Everybody remember that? He's part fish, part man. He is an idol. He is an idol that was created by the men themselves. They created their god. Any idol worshipers that may be listening, you are the one that creates your god in your own image. Come on, amen. That is not a god. The psalmist said it this way. Eyes have they because they carve eyes into them, whether they're wood, marble, stone, whatever they're made out of, granite, doesn't matter what material, eyes have they, but God said they cannot see your need. Ears have they carved in, but they can't hear your cry. Hands have they, but they can't reach out to you. Feet have they, but they'll never make it to where your sick baby is. They'll never make it to your hospital room where you need a miracle. Come on. Open mouths have they, but they cannot speak, and they cannot declare life. The priest of Dagon set the Ark of the Covenant in front of their idol, Dagon, half fish, half man, and they got plastered that night, and they celebrated. And what were they celebrating? The defeat of Israel's God. The defeat of, come on, amen, Jehovah. Huh? They got drunk. They all wandered back to their homes. They all had hangovers. And when they came in the next morning, much to their amazement, how many knows Dagon, amen, was falling down in front of the Ark of God? Dagon was bowed face down, amen, before that little box of gold. Come on, somebody. And your Bible said that the priest didn't understand it, but they had to help their God up. How many knows our God don't need no help? Jesus doesn't need your help. He doesn't need my help. He's God all by himself. He said, I am the Lord, the self-existent, eternal God. I'm in control. I don't need you, but you do need me, God said. Huh?
Yes.
And the priest of Dagon had to lift their god back up in place. And they toppled him back up in place. And they drank some more, and I realized this boot came untied. That's all right. Amen. And the Bible says, amen, that they got drunk again, and they left that night. And the next morning when they came in, guess where Dagon was? Face down again. Only this time his head was broke off, and his hands was broke off. Come on. Amen. I can imagine those priests were scratching their heads and said, Dagon! You'll remember that one. Remember what happened then? Plague of mice started breaking out in all of the villages of the Philistines. After that, hemorrhoids broke out on all the men. Yep. Somebody said, I can't believe you said that. Read your Bible. There's a lot of great stuff in that Bible. Sores. An emrod or a hemorrhoid means a mound of a sore that has come out like a boil on the skin that is full of pain and pressure. Finally, somebody spoke up and said, we're messing with something we don't know about. This God of the Hebrews is angry with us. Come on, amen. We've stirred him up. Come on, amen. He broke the head off of our God and the hands off of our God. And now we're all sick and we can't get healed. How many knows? There was no physician in the land. There was no doctor or medication that could take care of any of this. It was incurable. When will America wake up?
Yes. Amen.
When will the church wake up?
Amen.
And they said, somebody had some common sense. Somebody had a revelation from God. And somebody said, if we don't get this box out of here, we're going to end up, watch, like Pharaoh and Egypt back during the time of Moses. I'm going to tell you, our God is God, and in the end, He'll be God. And I can set every knee about, and every tongue will confess. So let me tell somebody that's discouraged tonight, don't give up on God. Don't give in your Christian faith. Don't tell the Lord things are getting worse, what's going to happen there. Hold on, child of God, because soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. Jesus is coming back, and you'll be glad that you held on. For Jesus said, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. Come on, church. Amen. Give God praise. Hold on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Speak, my brother.
Joe Senior wants God back in his life. Would you pray for
Praise
him?
Praise
right
God.
Now?
Where's he at? Is there a place?
He's online.
He's online.
He's in Blacksville.
Joe, listen to me, my precious brother. Whatever it was that got your eyes off of Jesus, whatever it was that caused you, amen, to forsake or leave God, right now tonight, the Holy Spirit's dealing with you, brother. Just tell him right now, with you pray it your way. But the Bible says, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. And Joe, he'll receive you tonight. The blood of Jesus will cleanse you of any and every sin. Just tell him right now, Jesus, I'm sorry. Forgive me, Lord. I'm sorry for backsliding. Come into my life. Lord God, save me. Change me. Transform me into your image. I believe and I put my faith in you. Keep me, Jesus, that I'll never turn away again. Now thank him, Joe. Give him praise. If you're in your home, wherever you're listening to this, give him praise and just let his presence, let the presence that I'm preaching to this congregation about, let it fill your heart. God, come right now and fill his life. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall upon Joe right now. Baptize him, Jesus, in the power and the Spirit of God. Fill him full of your joy. God, take away, amen, his sin. Take away, Lord, all the pain and all the, Lord God, the consequences of turning away. And God, give life now to my brother in death's place in Jesus' name. God bless you, Joel. God bless you. We love you. Hallelujah.
And one more, brother.
Go ahead, brother.
In Ohio,
Megan
wants prayer of salvation for her grandfather. He's in his 80s.
Jesus.
His health's deteriorating. She knows he doesn't have a lot of time,
Jesus.
But he needs Jesus.
Jesus, right now, Megan, thank you for standing in the gap for your grandfather. Believe what we pray. Come on, the Bible said if any two on earth, that's me and you, Megan, and there's more than two in this place, if they agree as touching anything, it'll be given to them of our God in heaven through the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for that grandfather right now. Lord, there's others that are watching, but they have lost loved ones. Some are family, some are children, sons and daughters, some are husbands and wives, aunts and uncles, brother-in-law, sister-in-law, brothers, sisters. God, right now, speak to Megan's grandfather. Arrest his heart, Holy Spirit, and let him know you're the revealer. You're the one who makes Jesus real. And I pray that you would let him know that he needs Jesus Christ. Maybe it'll be through Megan's witness. Maybe you'll lay on her heart to call grandfather. But God, I pray right now, save his soul. Satan, I rebuke you. We take authority over you. You can't have him. We claim him for Jesus Christ. Oh. God, I pray right now, and I feel led to pray this on behalf of Megan. Let her sense the nearness of your presence. Holy Spirit, right now, break that mindset that she's far away or she can't feel God like she used to. I rebuke that lie in Jesus' name. Lord, you're as close as the mention of your name. Just let her sense the presence of Jesus tonight. Oh, God bless you, honey. God bless you for being an intercessor for your grandfather and your family. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Come on, give God praise. Give God praise.
Hallelujah.
waiting on the Lord. I don't know if we're to finish right here or not. I'm not sure. I just want to wait on the Lord. Your Bible says that they sent that Ark of the Covenant back. If the Lord allows me tomorrow, if that's God's will, if it's God's will, I'd like to share the rest of it.
Yes.
Your Bible says that they got that ark. They realized we can't play. I want to finish with this. If you're going to play games with anybody, don't play games with God.
No. That's right. No. No.
Be not deceived.
Right.
God is not mocked.
No, he's not.
Whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. If you sow and plant the seeds to your flesh, you will of the flesh reap corruption. I'm surprised how many people live their lives with no God in mind and just living for themselves and their sinful pleasures. And yet when a tragedy strikes, they blame God.
Yes,
they didn't care about God. He says, if you sow to your flesh, if you plant seeds to your flesh, you're going to reap. You're going to get the harvest of your flesh, of corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, you'll of the Spirit reap life everlasting. I'm telling you, the Lord is speaking to those over the internet and maybe even here tonight. Listen, what kind of seeds are you planting? You can't plant potatoes and get corn. You can't plant green beans and get carrots. Come on. You're going to get what you plant. You can't work for Walmart and get your paycheck at Sheets. Come on. Amen. You can't work for McDonald's and get your paycheck, amen, at Golden Corral. If you serve the devil and serve your flesh and serve sin, you're going to get the paycheck of death, which is an eternal separation, the second death, the lake of fire. But the Bible says if you sow to the Spirit, you'll of the Spirit reap life.
Yes.
Life more abundantly. Stand with me, church. Stand with me. I'm hungry for His presence. God's moving in this house tonight. He's moving on our heart. I want to open these altars. I want us tonight just to seek the Lord. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Seeking for your individual life. If there's something personal that you need to tell God, if you're not where you need to be honest with God tonight. Come on, we can't fake it. You can't fake it till you make it. Not with God. God knows the real. God knows the real and the phony. Come on, and the hypocrisy. If you're a hypocrite in your walk, it's time to get things right with God. Come on, amen? Amen? Can we just come and as a church seek the Lord and let's just go after Him? Can that be your cry? Show me your glory, God. I want your manifested presence in my life, in my house, in my home, at my work, at my school, in my university, in my neighborhood, and in my church. I want the genuine presence of Almighty God. Brother, would you come and just lead us in something? Would that be okay? Unless you want to pray yourself, we'll put on a CD. I'll do it however you feel. I love you, brother. I appreciate you. Good to see you. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Allen. I love you, man. God bless you. All your heart, I love you. With all my heart, I love you. Amen. Praise be the name of the Lord. Come on, it's just time. If you just want to sit in His presence, that's fine. You may be seated if you want to sit, but I want us to talk with the Lord. I'm hungry, church. I'm hungry. I don't want a miracle to be occasionally every now and then when it's to be the norm in the house of God. I want His presence. I'm not going after Him. I'm just not going after His stuff. I'm just not going after what I can get to tickle my fancy. I need Him. How many knows if we have Him, it's about Him, His presence. If He's in the house, we have everything. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Can we just seek the Lord? Amen. As these songs are sung for the glory of God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Father, I pray for everybody online that's watching right now. Thank you, God, that they've tuned in tonight. God, nobody is watching by accident. Maybe there's someone that'll view this tomorrow or next week. Maybe they'll view it a month from now or 2 years from now. It doesn't matter. Lord, your word is the same. Your power is the same. And God, if they missed the time, they really didn't miss anything because you're there right now, wherever they're watching. God, save them. You said that those that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Thank you for your mercy and grace. Lord, bring healing. bring peace, bring deliverance, and it's all because of Jesus. He is the Prince of Peace. It's all about His presence. We love you. We're going to be back here tomorrow night and Saturday night at this same time. And thank you for watching. Please share a testimony. Let somebody know that you made things right with God. And find yourself a good Bible-believing church. This is a good one here. Pastor Hamrick will love you. Zohar House of Prayer, amen, in Morgantown. We love you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. You want to say anything else? Praise God. Praise God. Go ahead and sing. Sing it for the glory of God. Yes, God. Absolutely, absolutely. That's what we're going to do. Specifically. Oh, that sounds so good. Keep singing. Hallelujah. Ruthie, can you bring that bottle of water to me? Come pray with me, too. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for my precious brother. God, the person who knows himself for God. Before he dies in his sins, he sins. The Bible said the man who won't humble himself before God, he has an audience with God. He has God's mind in God. God, whatever my brother needs right now, brother, I feel that they just need a religion. Come over here and get it. Ask large. Don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid. Don't be minimal when you're asking. You're seeking for God. Ask large. Because He's a big God. He's a restorer. This will be better, God. He's a restorer of the past as well. He can take the years and the cankerworm, palmerworm, locust, and caterpillar of Eden. And He said, I'll restore all those years. He's a faithful God. He's a faithful God. Faithful is He who will call you the ruler of the people.
I know it's love. Let him obey. When you say move, let him move. God, don't let him move out of fear. Don't let him move out of frustration. Let him move because the Spirit of God says move now. In Jesus' name. Oh, he that has begun to move, work in you will perform it.
Cheers.